In this video, I build the instruction register on breadboards. There's a little bit of time at the end, so I talk a little bit about how we need to synchronize the control signals so that they all reach their components at the same time. Let's get right into it. Hi, my name is Adam. I'm building a 16-bit computer from scratch. I hope you'll join me on this journey. Okay, I've got the breadboards out again, and just to quickly remind everybody where everything is, this is my breadboard register, including all of the different buses up here where I can assert. This up here is address bus 1, which is looped down here to my temporary bus, address bus 1. This breadboard here is my temporary memory module stand-in. And it's very highly engineered such that the contents of every location in memory contains its address. In other words, it just passes the address on as if it's the data that's in there. This is my clock, and then this is just a little test harness in order to control the register. My clock has manual and automated mode, and then this is my fetch register. Off the top of my fetch register here is where I would hook in the instruction register, and it's the instruction register I want to work on today. So what I think I want to do here is slide this off to the side a little bit and disconnect my LED outputs and set those aside and bring in a board over here for my instruction register. I want to get that plugged in, and then I want to take both the left-hand side and right-hand side and prepare those so that I can plug them in down here. So this is my most significant. This will be my least significant. Yes. And then if all goes well, I can have that sit flat as I assemble this register, the instruction register. Now I'm going to do my best to put this all onto a single breadboard here. I know I've got two of them out, and the control logic associated with the instruction register is going to end up taking several breadboards, so I don't expect that one breadboard is actually going to be the end-all be-all of this entire instruction register with its control logic. And what I'm doing is I'm trying to line these up in such a way that I can fit it all on one breadboard. Now, I did do a little bit of pre-testing, if you will, to make sure that everything would actually fit. And if I orient it all right, it does, but just barely. So I'm going to move this over one, move this over one, and then this one both over one. And then to line these up, I need to check the document here. Pin 1 is output enable, so if I push this in at pin 2 and then push this in at pin 2, then I should be able to seat these 74LS, or actually HCT 574 ICs. So these two integrated circuits here. So this takes the input from the bottom, outputs on the top, 74LS 541 line drivers, take the inputs on the bottom, outputs on the top. So I'm actually going to flip these around just to make this a little easier to wire up. And then of course, with that comes the risk of me actually doing something totally incorrect and cooking an IC, which I've done before. And then lastly, then are the LEDs that I need to seat. There we go. And then so the inputs come in here, outputs here should go to the inputs to the line driver here, outputs here come to the inputs to the LEDs, and then grounded down here. So that's going to make this a little bit tough to wire up and get all the different ground connections I need in here, so I'm going to make an effort to do that. I only need 16 of these LEDs. I have 20 of them here, which means I need 16 holes here. So I'm going to end up well out into this area in order to get all of those 16 spots for my resistors. We have some pre-cut stuff, so let's just get right into this. Power. And I'll put a pin diagram up in the corner there so that you can follow along with my progress here. Get its ground for that, I see. Ground for that, I see. And then pin 1 is output enable. And then for this one, I'm actually going to have to construct a wire. So in the meantime, I'm going to put that there. Now, for this one, that's power. And that's ground. And again, I'm looking at the pinouts here. This one has pin 1 and pin 19. Both need to be tied low. Pin 19 is output enable, pulled low. Pin 1 is output enable, also pulled low. And then if I take my least significant bit from here, that's clock, from there to here, least significant bit from there. Yes, I've got that right. And then take an LED, sorry, resistor, and tie this to my ground point there. All I need to do now is borrow the clock from, I'm going to borrow it from here at the moment. And I should be getting output, and I'm not. Just make sure that this lights up, and it does not. Do I have power? Or do I have them in backwards? I have them in backwards. So that's the basic wire up. Now all I need to do is get it wired up for real. So I will work on that. Okay, so this resistor I could not fit up here, so I went ahead and just tied it to the signal here. Let me use a pointing device. So I tied this resistor here, I tied into this signal line here, which should be fine. It shouldn't create any problems here. I'm not going to do anything that's crazy enough for that's actually going to create a problem. I ended up cutting these just a hair too short. I actually had the right size and trimmed off a little bit just to make it a little bit cleaner. And that didn't work out well. Let's get the longest 4 I've got. I'm gonna have to redo these. Alright, well, I got them all to fit. Okay, I want to call to your attention that this is not perfect. And what I want to show you is that the address register here and the fetch register here and then the instruction register here don't remain in sync quite right. So what do I mean by that? So I have 0 over here, which is 1 clock cycle behind this over here, which has 1 in it, which is 1 clock cycle behind this over here, which has 2 in it. Now the difference here is expected and actually is required, but the difference here is not. This should be clocking properly. And to do that, I believe I just need to move this to the inverted clock rather than the clock itself. So let me click my way through this a little bit. Okay, so there, that just changed over, and that has the same value as that. So that then puts that in sync so that I'm getting the right timing. Some of these control signals are going to have to get wired together coming off the instruction register. Some of these signals are going to have to be ANDed together. Some of them have an exclusive OR, a NAND, or a NOR gate. Ultimately, what it boils down to is there is going to be some timing delay in some of these signals coming off of this particular circuit board. And we really need to make an effort to keep those in line. If some signals are delayed by an AND gate or an OR gate, everything really should be delayed similarly. Some signals need to be inverted. And the timing of, and let me see if I can bring up the data that I've captured here. Here's the thing, is that an AND gate has a 25 nanosecond delay. An OR gate has a 25 nanosecond delay. An inverter has a 24 nanosecond delay. And I think those two are close enough that I'm going to be able to live with those. I don't need them to be that exact. I'm not going to get the kind of clock speeds that would require that to be that exact. But conventional wisdom is to take two inverters and chain them together in order to create a clock delay. Well, if I do two inverters, that's 24 nanoseconds times 2, or 48 nanoseconds. And I think we can do better. So in the clock module, I put a 74LS125, the HC version of that, has a 45 nanosecond delay, worst case. Well, that's only marginally better than two inverters. But I think we can do better than that. An AND gate. If we wire the two inputs together, it becomes a buffer. And that is a 25 nanosecond delay. So 0 and 0 still remains 0. 1 and 1 still remains 1. An OR gate does the same thing. If I wire the two inputs together, it becomes a buffer. So 0 or 0 remains 0. 1 or 1 remains 1. Interestingly enough, an XOR gate can be either a buffer or an inverter. If I tie one of the inputs to 0, then the output is the same as the second input. 0 exclusive OR 0 is 0. 0 exclusive OR 1 is 1. On the other hand, if I tie one of the inputs high, then it becomes an inverter. 1 exclusive OR 0 becomes 1, and 1 exclusive OR 1 becomes 0. And between some combination of ANDs, ORs, and exclusive ORs, I should then be able to get the signals that I need exactly in time that I need. And if I need to add an additional delay in there for some reason or another, I can just pass it through another buffer or a second inverter or what have you in order to get the appropriate delay that I'm looking for. And I'm going to have to take all of that into account as I'm building out this control logic. Now, in the clock here, I used a NAND gate as an inverter. I only used one of those. Everything else was tied low. I think I'm going to have to replace that with an exclusive OR gate so that I can actually get the clock, an inverted clock, working exactly the way I want it to. Or I bring the clock signal in its native form to the control logic and perform the inversion here if I need an inverted clock. And I will likely do that because that keeps the clock itself pristine. And if I need an inverted clock, I can produce it here very easily. And I can also run that through that clock through a couple of XOR gates, splitting it so that I don't have to worry too much about fan out. Fan out on this high-speed CMOS is some 500 gates. I don't believe I'm going to hit that mark, but it's better to be prepared for that. I'll design some redundancy into this circuit so that I don't have to worry about getting anywhere close to the fan out limit. But as it stands right now, this is our instruction register. And the next thing to do is to go through and add control logic into that so that I can actually control the rest of this from what's going on in this instruction register. And the first thing I need to control is to set up for incrementing the program counter and asserting that onto the address bus 1 and fetching an instruction into the fetch register, where there are chance times where I may not want to fetch an instruction into the fetch register. And so we need to go through and identify when those situations would be and see what kinds of control signals that we need to construct to handle that. I've come to realize that the automatic captioning that takes place is rather inadequate. So I am going to go back through all of my historical videos and try to clean that up just to make it a little bit more accessible. Of course, that's going to slow things down a little bit, but I hope you'll bear with me as I get through this process. I do have several videos that I've got to go through and clean up. The next video is going to be about defining the control signals in terms of the clock cycle. I've got some diagrams that I've been working on in order to be able to describe that. And in doing so, it's clarified a couple of things for me. And I believe I'm going to end up ultimately changing how I have my clock cycle defined. So that will be coming up in the next video. At the same time, time permitting, I should be able to breadboard out everything I need for the no-op instruction to control. So no matter what instruction it is, it's treated as if it's a no-op, and then I should be able to free run the CPU at that point. I do still have several other things on my to-do list. I have not yet ordered the replacement PCBs for the registers. I still do want to get those ordered, but I am kind of procrastinating. I'm hoping to add a couple of extra things in there so that the economies of scale on shipping are worth my time there. And then, of course, I still have all the other things that are on my to-do list. Thank you. We'll see you soon.